Well, good evening, everyone. I'm Marty Feldman, Section Chair, Simply New England. And it's a pleasure to be here at Emerson College. We haven't been here in a while. I want to thank Tony Asenzo, the manager, Cheryl Lustenberger, assistant manager, and Tim MacArthur, the associate director of television, radio, and film here at Emerson College. As you can see, this is a first-class facility, and they keep it running that way. And we want to thank them very much for the studio. And tonight, we're going to see how the studio, how all of the core technology in this studio was revamped by Grass Valley. And it's really a pleasure to have Grass Valley with us as well, because we haven't done a meeting with Grass Valley in quite a while. And they're almost an icon in the industry. I remember working with Grass Valley Equipment and Master Control in 1969, using sink strippers and lots of interesting primitive equipment that worked great back in the analog days. And everyone has come a long way, and you're going to see some amazing technology here that uses retains the use of current technology like SDI, but now embraces the use of IP, which is, in a few years, will be probably taking over everything in terms of infrastructure within and without the studio. A few things I wanted to mention. Emerson has graciously invited us to a tour of the studio and Master Control right after the meeting. Tim, thank you very much for that. So see Tim right after the meeting, and we'll organize groups to see all of the equipment here. Tonight, we have John Palmer. Where are you, John, from Grass Valley? And actually leading the presentation will be Bruce Lane. And in addition to having done everything at Grass Valley, he also has a local connection because for 16 years he was at WSBK, Channel 38, and worked his way all the way up to engineering manager. So it's great to have him back with us. I want to mention that tomorrow, the Society of Broadcast Engineers has a meeting at noon at WGBH on Guest Street. The presenter is Zixi. How many here are familiar with Zixi? One, two. Okay. They're leaders in transporting IP and have some amazing error correction. It should be a very interesting meeting, so if you can make that. Emmerich is here from GBH, and you should probably let him know because they need to know how many people are attending.
At noon time.
At noon, yes, it's noon, and I think there'll be a luncheon, if I'm not mistaken. So, I also want to, I see that we have some Emerson students here, and I want to welcome them, and we always encourage student participation in SMPTE. A student can join SMPTE for as little as $35 a year, or if that's a problem, there are scholarships available. So through very generous donors, it's possible for a student to join SMPTE without any cost at all. We have applications here. And for the rest of you who would like to join SMPTE, you can become an associate member for $45 a year or a full member for $145 a year. For $145 a year, you get the SMPTE Motion Imaging Journal, which is a marvelous technical journal. And you also get access to webinars and all kinds of other technical data that is available only to SMPTE members. And if you go on the SMPTE website, which is SMPTE.org, you'll see that there are video on demand course materials that members can access on really almost everything that you need to keep up with these days. In fact, there's one tomorrow. So they're live and then they're archived. So that was just a marvelous resource for SMPTE members. So now it's my pleasure to introduce Bruce Lane, who will talk about all of the technology that you see here and that Grass Valley is working on to make our lives easier in the industry. Bruce?
Thank you, Mark. On behalf of Grass Valley, thank you everybody for coming out tonight. I really appreciate the response. Don't hold the questions to the end. If you have a question, raise your hand. If I don't see you, just yell it out. Let's make this as informal as possible and hopefully as informative as possible. And if I make a mistake, it's John Palmer's fault. If I get it right, it's my fault.
Bruce, one thing I do want to say is Grass Valley did the switchers and the cameras here. There's plenty of other gear from other manufacturers.
Yeah.
This was not just our event. This was a coordinated, well-coordinated event.
There are a couple of things that I'm going to go over. One of the things I was asked to talk about was 4K or ultra high definition, high dynamic range, wide color gamut, a little bit about higher speed cameras, where are some of the usages, and what are some of the issues associated with that. As well, and Marty mentioned the IP infrastructure, where are we going, where is the world going with SMPTE 2022, what are some of the things that advantages it brings, and how do we work within that. And then there's also two industry groups that I'll at least mention. One is Aspen and one is Ames, and they're both working to find interoperability between manufacturers and help us with 4K, because 4K doesn't today fit in a 10 gig pipe, which is a SMPTE 2022. So how are we going to get 12 gigs down a 10 gig pipe? To start off, 4K does not, by definition, at least within Wikipedia, does not refer to how many lines of resolution, just purely how many pixels across the screen. That'll become apparent later on when I point to some of the usages, specifically in stadiums. The two 4Ks that I would refer to are the one used in digital cinema, which is sometimes referred to as true 4K, because you really are 4,096 pixels across the screen. That could be referred to as true 4K. The other one, and what I will spend the rest of my presentation talking about, and if I call it 4K, really we're talking about UHD, ultra high definition, is 3840 by 2160. If you do the math, just cut them both in half, you end up with 1920 by 1080. Big surprise. And that's why we call it Quad HD or UHD. It's basically four 1080p signals and that represent one UHD signal. So for the rest of the presentation, if I call it 4K, I'm talking UHD. In 2013, the EBU put out a prediction. Don't bother, I mean, if you can read it, go ahead. But we're at 2016 now, and there are already more 4K productions done than the EBU had estimated when they put this out in 2013. So we're further ahead than people would have expected us to be at this time. I think the adoption towards 4K is faster than expected, but it's not without concern and cost, and from an engineering perspective, there's a lot of consideration that goes into putting together a 4K production. So how is it being used today? Grass Valley has done a number of 4K productions. We did this in part to make sure that all of what we were proposing to our customers actually worked. So we actually have to go out and test it. So we put together a 4K truck in one case with cameras shooting 4K, a production switcher running in 4K, routing switcher switching four signals at the same time. By the way, for any of you who are as old as I am, you'll remember digital RGB component. That was three signals that had to be in time. Now there are four. And the timing is even more critical today than it was in RGB, and I'll get into some of the issues associated with that as I go through the presentation. But we went through a full production, and we even transmitted that over satellite to IBC in 2014, and we showed it to the people who came to IBC in Amsterdam in 14, I believe it was a soccer match. So where is 4K being used today in production? The first and the easiest is just use it as an onset monitor. If you're putting graphics into an onset monitor, or if you're putting actual video into the onset monitor, the video can be upconverted to 4K. You can use it on the screen. Why would you do that? 4K monitors on set are more expensive than HD monitors, so why are you going to spend the extra money just to get 4K? The answer is, if you zoom in on the talent, you're also zooming in on the screen, the onset monitor, and as a result, you can end up with just a small portion of that screen, but effectively amplified by the camera, and as a result, you can see pixelization, especially in the graphics. Now, this isn't a good example because I stole these pictures off of the internet, and I zoomed in to make it artificially appear to do what I'm talking about, and the active picture is active video. So it wouldn't necessarily help as much there. But when you're zooming in, at least if you've upconverted and you've done a nice job, you're going to have a better picture resolution to work with than you would otherwise if you were using an HD monitor. So that was the first place. And ORAD is a big proponent of this. They'll provide their own graphics. They'll do the upconversion as a manufacturer. There are others that would do that as well. And they would point out that the picture quality will be better when seen in this type of a format. One of the biggest for 4K is sports replay. So here you shoot with a 4K camera, the outside part of the screen, and I'm just going to kind of move around here. You would end up zooming in to either the orange box or the green box when you wanted to, when it was appropriate to do it within the sports replay. 4K gives you four times as many pixels, four times the resolution, means you can zoom in much further before the picture by itself diminishes. Now, when you think of any of these zoom technologies, it's basically an outboard DVE. That's all we're doing when we do it. So think of a DVE that you use on a production switcher, and you're all used to doing this. There's a point at which, when you digitally zoom in, the picture starts to go down. If you start with more pixels to begin with, you can zoom in further. It's pretty simple math, okay?
So if I may, if you're like ESPN and you're transmitting or you're acquiring and transmitting in 720, then that box gets even smaller, doesn't it?
The box doesn't get smaller. The output is down converted to 720.
Oh.
So in this case, you have a 4K camera capturing an image. Through SMPTE fiber, it goes back to the base station. It's recorded into a server. It's recorded into a server on four BNCs. So it's four codecs to record it. Inside of the server, that's four separate files. You record it into the server, and when you play it back, you play back four files. So you have four record channels and four playback channels. This is just straight math, okay? The replay controller controls an outboard DVE. That DVE takes in a 4K signal and then outputs whatever format you want. 4K, 1080i, 1080p, 720p, whatever you want. The size of the image, we're just down converting the output, so there's no change to the size of the image. People would say, well, if you squeezed in, if you did a 4:1 squeeze, not compression, if you did a 4:1 squeeze, zoom, then you effectively would have a 1080p or a 1080i output with no degradation in signal. That is true, although you are rendering the output, you're down converting the output so that there is potentially some loss, but you're pretty much doing a pixel for pixel change, okay? And you end up with a zoomed in image, which may tell you more about what you needed to know and help you determine did she hit the ball before it hit the sand, or did it hit the sand first? That's for any of you who are looking at the ball.
Not that it makes much difference.
But the four signals, is that actually a quadrant, or is it every fourth pixel?
It is quadrants.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And I'll get into describing a little more on that when we get into some of the challenges, because you can do it as quadrant or four different resolutions. Okay. So sports venues, what's going on in the sports venue world? I've spent the last 5 to 6 years of my life working with stadiums across the country. One of the first ones I dealt with was the Seattle Mariners. So at the Seattle Mariners, they put in a Daktronix, I think it was Daktronix, could be a Mitsubishi screen in either case. Back to the point of, remember I said Wikipedia says it's 4,000 pixels? It has nothing to do with lines? You have 4,000 pixels. You have 1080 lines at the Seattle Mariners Stadium. Some people would say, is that really 4K? By definition, that is a 4K picture. It's only half of the height, but it's a 4K picture, okay? And how do we get to that when the production is done? I put 1080p 60, but in the Mariners case, because this is a generic diagram, in the Mariners case, it was done in 1080i, okay? The output of the production switcher goes into a Vista Spider. The Spider actually paints onto the canvas the image that you see. The canvas that it paints onto is whatever shape and size is available to the stadium. The Dallas Cowboys have two screens, one facing east and one facing west. Okay, they have Vista Spiders for each screen. The new Atlanta Falcons stadium is going to have a ring around the center where there's an opening, and that ring is actually going to be continuous video. And on top of that, it's going to be tilted in. So the top of the video is going to be a shorter distance than the bottom of the video. I believe right now there are between 7 and 9 Vista Spiders to make that image happen. Okay? Now it will repeat around the ring. It's not going to be one wrapped image. It'll be sections. But they will be able to paint onto that canvas whatever they want. In this case, they're painting a camera onto the Mariners canvas. So how do you shoot 32x9 with a Grass Valley LDX camera? You put in an extra set of graticules, and you ignore the bottom 25%, and you ignore the top 25%. I might not have the graticules exactly right. This is a mocked-up image. But you take the 50% in the middle, and you have 32x9. Okay, the Vista Spider also has other inputs. So you've got the production switcher, you've got a clip player, you've got graphics engines. You might have multiples of those. The Spider decides what's on the screen at any one time. You could have a full screen graphic up there. In which case, if it comes from here, it's probably natively 4K, but it's also natively built to be 1080 lines of resolution. Okay, so they'll build graphics to meet the display, and they'll put that up there. Other things that you can do? The production switcher can be here, 16x9, or some representative 16x9. Usually it's dead center, and then the sides are either graphics or advertising. Okay, the graphics or advertising could be a clip played back from their clip player, natively 4K, or advertising played back from the clip from a graphics device. That is all considered 4K production. Okay, go ahead.
Are they using dedicated cameras for this, or are they?
All stadiums have their own dedicated cameras. In the case of the Seattle Mariners, they have 4 dedicated Grass Valley cameras that are just for the scoreboard. They also take 4 to 6 cameras from the truck bay. So they'll take like the program and potentially tight, so camera 1 and camera 2, and they might take a couple of ISO cameras. If they don't, they'll pick cameras that are not matching the existing angles that they have themselves. That also can, in the case of a stadium, can cause issues, because if the stadium's running in 1080i and a Fox truck pulls up and does the game in 720p, they've got to do up conversion or cross conversion to get from 720p to 1080i. So there's no free lunch here. There's a lot of work that goes into putting together a stadium show. Stadium show also has other aspects to it that are completely different than a broadcast show. Those of you that are broadcast think the output of the production switcher is the king of all kings. It's what goes to air. In the case of a stadium show, it's the output of the Spider that's the king of all kings. You're just a source into that. So for example, when you go to replay, If you're doing replay for Nesson, then there'll be some kind of an animated wipe that will reveal the replay. In the case of a stadium show, that's where they make their money. That animated wipe is a sponsored wipe. Sponsors pay for they're the advertising venue. And that sponsored wipe is not going to happen in this small area. It's going to be a wipe that's going to go all the way across the screen, and it's going to reveal the replay. So when they do it, that sponsored wipe will usually take up the full screen at one point, cover the whole canvas, and say, replay brought to you by Budweiser, and then it's going to reveal the replay. So how do you program all that to happen? The TD actually does the programming of the event. The TD drives the spider. In Daktronics' case, it also drives a program called Show Control, which is Daktronics' control for the show, and it will drive that. How does it do that? It does it through VDCP, but over Ethernet, so eVDCP. It treats this like it's a clip server, even though this is really a video processor. So it just has, to the TD, it's a clip name, play, recue, pause. There might be rewind or whatever, but there are just a few effects. So when you call up something, the effect might be prepare to do this, and you're preparing the spider, you're preparing a clip player, you're preparing something in here, and then based on the timeline of the effect, meaning come full screen and cover the switcher, undercut the replay, and then reveal the replay. And that all happens through the timeline of the switcher.
The TD you're talking about, it's the Jumbotron TD you're talking about.
Yes.
Not the TD in the truck.
Correct.
Okay, that's what I
thought. In this case, I should have put it on the left-hand side. The truck cameras are just another feed into this production switcher. So this is only for the scoreboard. And the fact that they may have to do other things, when they interface to show control for Daktronics, that also affects the ribbon board that goes around, which is fed by another complete server that feeds the ribbon board. And in that case, it's not 32 by 9. It might be in the case of 128 by 9 kind of aspect ratio. And it's fed by a very specific server, usually a ClickFX. And that feeds the ribbon board. And in the case of stadiums, they go for something called a moment of exclusivity. So when LeBron James comes back into the game for the Cleveland Cavs, everything in the stadium says LeBron. The scoreboard says it, the ribbon board says it, the TVs behind the bar say LeBron's coming back in. They hit four or five different program feeds that are all different, but synchronously, they're all doing something that coordinates with a moment of exclusivity to say it's LeBron's time to come back in. Same is true for... Unfortunately, we lost to the Broncos, but I did a lot of work with the Broncos over the last 3 or 4 years. And when Peyton wants it quiet, trust me, there's a moment of exclusivity. It actually says shh, and they have a horse with a finger going shh kind of thing. And it says shh on the ribbon boards. And if the audience isn't quiet enough, I've been in the control room when Peyton has called the control room to read them the riot act because one time the announcer actually said, another Broncos first down, and the audience went crazy, and Peyton was under center when the audience went crazy. As soon as he went three and out, he called the control room, and on no uncertain terms, it never happened again. Which is too bad that it didn't happen Sunday. just saying. Another place that 4K has been used and will continue to be used is in acquisition. So why would you go with 4K if you can't broadcast it over the air? Now you want to get the best footage you can get whenever you can get it. The example I used earlier today was for the students, and then I realized just now that they probably don't know who Bobby Orr is, but that's a different story.
I was going to talk to you about that.
When I worked for SBK and we covered the Bruins, we did the best we could do to make the pictures as pretty as they could be. But we were working with TK-47 cameras, which were analog cameras, and they were standard definition. And when I look at that footage today on YouTube, I cringe and say, my God, compared to what we see today, there's no comparison. Had we had better equipment to start with, we would have had better images to work with today. So today we're talking about, you know, we work in HD and we're talking about 4K as an example. How different is that from 10 years ago when I would stand in front of audiences like this and say, oh, we're going to do mezzanine compression in our router to get HD out there, or whatever I was talking about at the time. We were talking about, you know, how are we going to deal with archive footage that doesn't compare, in that case it was aspect ratio and resolution, how are we going to deal with it? Today, if you can afford to, shoot in the highest possible resolution possible, edit in that native resolution or produce in that native resolution, and then output, down convert to whatever the project would be. So that works well in edit suites. In the case of the stadium market, they would shoot in 4K, they would edit in 4K. The only thing they would do is render or crop the top and bottom to fit their 32:9 aspect ratio or whatever the aspect ratio of their scoreboard was. In the case of mobile production trucks, Phil Garvin owns a mobile TV group out of Denver, Colorado. He has looked at, he brought a truck to NAB last year. It was a Grass Valley truck, so I can say proudly that it was filled with our equipment, production switchers and cameras and routing switchers and things like that. It was all set up with the same cameras that you see in this studio, which are the 86s that support 4K and high frame rate, 6X. It also had our replays in it and other products in it, so that he could produce an entire broadcast in 4K. In his case, the truck was designed to be switchable between 4K, 1080p, and 1080p with high frame rate cameras and things like that, so that depending upon the production that he was doing, he would meet the production's needs. But if the client was willing to pay for it, he could do a full up 4K production. So I mentioned 4K and high frame rate. You know, what are the differences and what are the advantages? If you take a look at the two of them, I have said for several years, they're both tools. Pick the right tool for the application. One is not better than the other. They are different. High frame rate has more applications in sports, my opinion, than does 4K. 4K in the right sport or the right application provides the ability to zoom in and it gives you better resolution. If you're talking about shooting a golf match, 6X or 8X isn't fast enough for a golf match for a replay anyways. So you're going to have to use some kind of a specialized camera like a Phantom or a Gazelle or something like that. So there, go with 4K. You're going to have specialized cameras on, you know, the swing analysis and things like that, where you might be capturing at 15 or 18 times speed. But the beautiful vista of a golf match makes sense for 4K. If you're talking about covering hockey or baseball or basketball, football, go with high frame rate, is my opinion. This is the same shots that you saw earlier. Again, look at the sand. When we zoom in, and in this case, we're zooming from there to there, what happens? We take that picture and we zoom in. She's out of focus. She's not actually out of focus. She's blurry. Why is she blurry? Because she's moving faster than 60 frames per second can capture. In that case, you need to capture faster if you expect to avoid motion blur. Motion blur is just a fact of nature. It's just physics. This is a case of we shot with a 6X camera. We shot a college football game. Up here, the runner's foot is clearly in bounds. When he takes his next step, he's out of bounds. We did the zoom, and in this case, we took in 6X into a server, used the Zoom, and we were outputting 1080i or 1080p because it was going to the scoreboard. By the way, in the stadium market, it's a closed loop system. They have their own TV, one giant TV. Sometimes they have some side panel TVs and they have the down converted stuff for behind the bar. But the big scoreboard is one giant TV. They can be whatever format they want to be. They don't have to worry about getting it to the home. They don't go to the home. NBC or CBS goes to the home. They just take care of the audience. So in this case, we overturned the call that was on the field. The call that was on the field was a touchdown. It actually changed the output of the game. This was within about a minute and a half of the end of the game. We can do it with our full-up camera that you see here, or our box camera. The high-speed box camera is something that's being used by Major League Baseball now for analysis games. Hockey has changed it as well. 2 years ago, the NHL changed the size of the net. They did that so the players could come around quicker and do a wraparound. They didn't change the opening. That would be dramatic. What they did is they changed the size of the net, so physically there was more room between the net and the backboards, and so that the players could make a faster turnaround. Okay. One of the results was the distance between the goal line and the crossbar that's in the back of the net, and it's actually physically straight like that. This came right out of the NHL rule book. Is now 14 inches, 0.275. If you do the math, and I did it on a spreadsheet so I wouldn't get it wrong, in 60 frames, a 100 mile an hour slap shot or a 100 mile an hour baseball travels 2.44 feet. That works out to 29 inches. This is 14 plus. You go in and you come out. You've traversed 28 inches in one frame of video. The puck goes faster than that. What it means? On frame one, you could be outside the net here. You go in, bounce off, and come back out. The very next frame, you're outside of the net. There's not a picture in the world of that puck in the net. That makes some assumptions. That the frame actually happened exactly when the puck was just about to go in or out. Trust me, the NHL cares about this. They're looking at replacing the cameras over the net with point of view cameras that are high frame rate for this exact reason. So there's a case where 4K would do you no good. They were originally looking at 4K cameras because they wanted to capture the two face-off circles and the whole corner, until they realized that it doesn't matter how big an image you can capture, if you're zooming in on a picture that doesn't show you what you need to see, you've missed the most important part of it. So what are some of the challenges associated with it? And by the way, I'm going through this at a pretty quick pace, but if you do have questions, stop me. Otherwise, I'll go through at a quick pace because I've got a lot of slides to go through. And I worked on them really hard for the past few days, so I'm going to get through them. So there are some challenges associated with high frame rate and other aspects. One, cabling. When you're talking about 4K, I said it's Quad HD is one of the industry terms we use. There are four BNCs, and on each of those BNCs, you're running a 1080p 60 signal. So that means that if you have a production switcher, and I will say we're the only ones in the world that have a production switcher with 192 inputs, that's what, 48 inputs in 4K. If you've got 96 outputs, again, the biggest production switcher in the world, you've got 24 outputs. Start doing the math. If you're going to cover a baseball game, you're normally using 12 cameras, two Chirons, and about six replay machines. Did I already run out of inputs? Pretty darn close to it, okay? If you've got other servers that are doing clip server application, commercial playback, you run out of source inputs very quickly in 4K. Now, you can feed it all through your routing switcher. If you're talking about a truck, every truck rolls off the finished production line at about 97.5% of its weight. And that's not with our big production switcher in it. That's with our smaller one that has 80 inputs by 48 outputs. That's not with a routing switcher that is somewhere in the 580 squared range, but one that's in the 256 by 512 range. You quadruple the size of the router, you add weight and power. Power requires air conditioning, and weight is unavoidable. And once you go from 97.5 to over 100%, you pay money every time that truck hits the road, okay? You also shorten the life of the truck expectancy because you're putting more wear and tear on the springs and the shocks and everything else. The other thing, I have no problem with 4K because you would spend a lot more money with Grass Valley. To get to 4K, you need four mix effects buses to make one. Simple math. Each mix effects buses. Now, we have a software program called Double Take, so we can turn one mix effects bus into two. In this case, I'm taking a 4ME switcher, ME1 primary and secondary, ME2 primary and secondary. That becomes one 4K mix effects bus. If you have six keyers per ME, put three of them on the primary side and three of them on the secondary side, you now go from six keyers per ME down to one 4K ME with three keys. And if you have a 4ME switcher with double take, you end up with a 2ME 4K switcher. That's a lot of resources to get an image on the screen. In addition to that, here's the four quadrants. Timing is, question.
In that sort of situation, how would you handle the mixing of 1080p sources and 4K sources?
Good question. Let me finish the timing and I'll get back to that. Timing is critical. In the days of component digital, if one of the signals was delayed because you didn't cut the cables closely enough, what was the result? The result was that you kind of had a registration issue. You usually saw it on somebody's shoulder or around their head. Red and green might be a little bit out of sync with one another. So if I moved my head back and forth, you know, like I was a 16-year-old, you'd see like halo effects. But for the most part, it wasn't that, it was noticeable, trust me. But it was not like you lost your mind. If the timing is off here, this quadrant is happening at a different time. It's incredibly obvious because you have sharp edges. So it's very, very obvious. Now, in the case of, you said 1080, like a single 1080i or 1080p signal, you can use external conversion. So feed that into an up converter. One signal going in, four signals going out, and that comes into the switcher as a four-signal process thing. We're actually doing this for the Sacramento Kings right now. We're designing their studio, and one of the questions they have is how many of the truck cameras, because they're trying to do a full 4K, a real 4K broadcast to their screen, but how many of the truck cameras can they take in? And it's a budget question, because how many up converters can they afford? And how many sources into the switcher can they afford? Okay. As we move to next generation of software, we will move to something on the production switcher whereby we won't be necessarily doing it in four quadrants. We will actually do it in four levels of resolution. Okay. So each signal will be a full screen 1080p signal, but it'll have one of the four pixels. And then the next one will have the adjacent pixel to the right, the third one will have the pixel to the bottom left, and then the pixel to the bottom right. Effectively, they'll all have the resolution of 1080p 60. When you do that, you can actually take that camera truck feed in as one signal, and you just tell the switcher that it doesn't have three other signals associated with it, and what you get is a lower resolution but 4K picture, okay? And it's not segmented frames, but I think it's PSF is the acronym for it. So there is an acronym for how you do that.
Excuse me.
Go ahead.
Going back to the Mariners,
yeah.
Where you had a 32x9 display within the stadium, the cameras they're using are essentially 4K natively.
No, they're 1080i or 1080p.
The cameras in the stadium are 1080.
Yeah.
Oh.
So the whole production is being
upscaling quite a bit at that point.
Yes. Yeah. They could be 4K, but they would have had to purchase 4K cameras. They would have had to purchase more mix effects buses for their switcher, more inputs to their switcher, more outputs to their switcher. They would have had to quadruple the size of the routing switcher, and they barely had enough money to buy the excellent cameras that they had. Okay?
Okay.
So, yes. And in this case, 1080i and 1080p don't cause those problems, but they're generally more expensive in the cameras and the production switcher and things like that.
Yeah. Outside of simple wipes, how do more complicated wipes get synchronized?
Actually, that's a good question, and you remembered it from earlier. Before we get into the more complex, we'll deal with the simple wipes for the rest of the audience. So in 4K, ME1 primary, ME2 primary, ME1 secondary, ME2 secondary. So a horizontal wipe is, from left to right, pretty easy, right? You start this ME and this ME at the same time, and then at some point, they've finished their wipe, and then this one starts. Okay? Same going this way, it's just different wipes. If you, God forbid anybody ever does a heart-shaped wipe, they should be shot, but even on Valentine's Day. But if you did a circle wipe, right, then you actually cut a piece of a pizza pie out, and that starts this way and goes out. This one starts this way, and this one this way. Very complicated to program four mix effects buses to do something at the same time. They're at least symmetrical. If you do some kind of a box-shaped wipe, by the way, we're 16x9, right? So we're not a square. Right off the bat, you have a problem, and you have to time things differently to deal with 16x9. Because you're not doing a box in here and a box in here. You're doing a corner of a box and a corner of a box and a corner of a box. And the sides have to go faster than the top and the bottom. So more complex wipes? Today in 4K, I guarantee none of the programs are doing them. Most of them are doing some kind of a DVE wipe over the top that covers the whole thing. And that's, again, more like the horizontal wipe or something like that. Or they'll do a flash and a reveal. Because it's kind of easy to do a flash and reveal. It's the same thing everywhere. There might be a slight starting from the middle out or something like that. But you can program that because if it's symmetrical, you can program that and then just turn it on its side, turn it on its side, turn it on its side, and they all start from the middle going out. Okay? If you get into something really complex, you're going to pull your hair out. I don't have any, but you do. Go ahead.
When using the other way of getting a 4K signal with the four 1080p's at separate resolutions, would that make transitions easier?
Back to normal.
Okay. Yep. It's just one frame.
Because you're dealing, yeah, at that point, the four images are, instead of being four quadrants, it's like they're behind each other. It's like they're four layers, okay? So you're doing the same thing on all four layers. You can even go back to that ugly heart-shaped wipe.
Why didn't we just do this from the start?
I have no idea. From engineering, it quad HD was the way to go. It only started with SMPTE 2022, where people started doing the layered effect for 4K. And it's not well accepted. Everybody is doing the quad today. The layered is something that is on the roadmap for most manufacturers. Go ahead.
So at some point in time, will current systems configured for quad be made legacy able so that the current quad systems can do the four resolutions?
I can only speak for Grass Valley, and the answer is that we want to make it across the board, okay? Other manufacturers may or may not be able to do that, and we may or may not be able to do that based on the devices we're talking about. For example, if we're talking about servers, I'm not sure whether the servers can actually do it or not. I would assume that they can. Production switchers is kind of easy because you're talking layered technology. If it's purely just four 1080p 60 signals, then you're recording it on four channels of a server and playing it back on four channels of a server. It should be straightforward. That's easy for me to say, and the engineers would have a heart attack that I just invented a new feature. They'll get over it.
No, I'm documented.
It's not the first time that I've created features on the fly. So how do you make 4K, or in our case, UHD? One is you take a regular pixel, a 1080p pixel, and you derive 4K out of that. I'll show you on another slide how to do that. If you actually understand the math, I'll buy you a drink afterwards. The other is make the pixels 25% the size. These two are all doing it with a 2/3 inch sensor. Okay? You make the pixels 25% the size. You now have twice as many pixels across, twice as many pixels down. You're now 4K by 2160, whatever it is, and your true 4K over here. Here you're derived. The other way to do it is derive it using a bare filter. But that requires, that's generally done with a 4/3 inch sensor. So a sensor that is about twice the size. Instead of 2/3 inch, it's a 4/3 inch sensor. Twice the size, that's diameter. So as far as surface area, there's probably four times the surface area on there. And you use a different methodology to get 4K. I would still say this is somewhat derived as opposed to actual. That would be debatable. Some people would debate me on that. If you're going to do that, you also have to deal with some other artifacts. When you go to a smaller sensor, in today's technology, you can only fit three transistors on each pixel. The transistors are associated with each pixel because that's how you read the image out of the photoprocessor. Okay? Three transistors means you read that information out line by line. Why is his golf club curved? It's not because he swung that hard and stopped, okay? It's because at the time that he had his hands here, when we got down to that line, the golf club was actually aimed out here. He's moving the golf club so quickly that by the time we start reading out, the club head is actually physically moved within one frame of video from here to here. So what you're seeing is we read it out and the club head moved. That's a rolling shutter. That's another example. I'll show you some pictures later. So rolling shutter has with it artifacts that are unavoidable. This is, again, just physics. The other thing is when you reduce the sensitivity, if the pixel is a quarter the size of another pixel, it's going to receive a quarter of the light. Now, the pixels can be better. We faced this when we went from SD to HD. Everybody said, oh my God, HD cameras in the newsroom, the talent is going to be sweating bullets because they'll have so much light on them to be able to make pictures that we're going to have to increase the air conditioning. Well, guess what? We didn't have to do that. We ended up with LED lights, and we ended up with more sensitive photo arrays and things like that. So we were able to handle this, but today, as we go to 4K, it's still a physics. You drop the pixel size by to 25%, you get 25% of the light. And if you capture that image at faster than real time, like 4x or 8x, you get 4 times less or 8 times less. Okay, it's just physics. And light sensitivity gets to depth of field. Because the more you compress the iris, the sharper the picture gets. The more you have to open up the iris, the lower your depth of field gets. Again, you know, Fuji or Canon can expound on this, and they can describe everything in great detail for you. One of the issues you have with depth of field, imagine a football game. What if from the tackle to tackle is in focus, but the ends are out of focus? So Gronkowski is blurry, but Brady is sharp. That's not an acceptable picture. Okay? You want to have a certain amount of depth of field. Also, if in football, as an example, if you take some of the newest high-end lenses, 109 by, and you're the camera one, center field camera, on the kickoff, you're supposed to go in and get the football tight. So that means from several hundred feet away, you're supposed to zoom in on a football that is moving from the left-hand side of the field to the right-hand side of the field. It changes its distance from you continuously as it goes. It gets closer to you, and then it gets further away as it goes across the field, as you pan across the field. If your depth of field is so short, you'll never keep it in focus. Camera operators go crazy when they lose depth of field because it makes their life very, very challenging. And it's actually very easy to track something that's coming towards you, and it's incredibly hard to track a baseball going away from you. Ask anybody that's run camera two, which is home plate. You'd much rather be out of camera four in center field watching the ball come at you, okay? Because basically you just zoom out. You don't have to worry about tracking focus. When you zoom out, everything stays in focus, okay? I mean, that's how a cameraman cheats or a camera woman cheats. Tracking it as you're zooming in on something and it's going away from you, very challenging. So if you lose that depth of field, you lose that range where it stays in focus, it's a serious problem. So for anybody who cares, this is how you derive 4K from a typical 1080p sensor, okay? This is the break between, this is the camera side, and this is in the base station. In the camera side, you capture 1080p red, green, and blue. You send that signal back to the base station. It converts it into 444, and then down converts it into 422 and outputs it. And if you expect me to explain the mathematics behind, you're way overestimating my capability. Okay? I do have another slide that goes into more detail if anybody wants to see it. But you can, with three 2K signals, you have 6K of data, you can interpolate 4K of data. You do not have the resolution that you would have when a camera captures with native 4K sensors, but you have more dynamic range and you have greater depth of field. So there are trade-offs in each situation. Some other images of what happens if you do not have a global shutter. A global shutter meaning you capture the entire image at once, as opposed to line by line. That's a rolling shutter. So, for example, and I actually think this image of the car is backwards, because I think the line should be going the other way. But in this case, I think either the camera is panning to the right or the car is in reverse, because these posts should be straight up and down, but the posts are actually moving to the right. Tells me the camera's reversed, but... the other thing is you'll lose pieces of the image that just weren't there. There are more propellers here than there are on the physical plane. This is a created image. It's meant to show you what happens when someone takes a flash photography, and instead of having a white flash, you only have a flash on the lines that were being written out at the time that the flash happened. if the flash happens in less than a 60th of a second, it doesn't, if the white part of the flash is only in the air, let's say, for less than a 60th of a second, you only see it on the time that it was apparent, because the flash was gone by here as we were writing out. So you end up with lines on the screen when someone takes a flash photography. That's not what you and I see when we're standing in the room. We all see one white flash, and it covers our whole field of vision. So so how do you avoid that so-called global shutter? To do that, you add two more transistors to every pixel. And why didn't we do this sooner, and why did we do it recently? Older technology was built this way with 25 micron transistor technology. So the transistors were physically big. If we put five of them on, the photodiode actually became very small. When we went to 18 micron transistor technology, we were able to still use a large photodiode. In this case, had we done it here, we would have had that same issue with light sensitivity, because we would have reduced the light sensitivity of the pixel by 50%. Another issue that shows up in sports with high frame rate is how you capture it. I showed on some of the other images how we capture it, and I'll go into a little more detail related to it. If you use typical technologies available today, this could be a Grass Valley camera, or it could be the Sony 4300. We capture at 6x, they capture at 8x. They go back to their base station, they output into a server controlled by some kind of a replay controller. This could be Grass Valley, this could be Dreamcatcher, this could be EVS. Any one of us are capable of doing it. And you can output a live image. That means that in this workflow model on the bottom, we're recording the entire game from start to finish. You can replay something instantly. There is no delay. You already have it. So you can cue up the replay. The pitch is about to leave. The ball is about to leave the pitcher's hand. You can mark your endpoint and cue up the pitch. It hasn't even made it to the bat. You're queued up, ready to do the replay, assuming something magnificent happens. In this case, this is the Phantom camera. The Gazelle works the same way. They have memory inside the camera. So they output a live stream, a 1080i, 1080p, 720p stream. They output that live. What they record inside the camera is generally 10x or more. So in the case of that baseball pitch, well, first of all, you have to watch it live to see if it was worthy of a replay. Assuming it's worthy of a replay, you then, from the controller, you trigger it to play back the recorded material. It plays it back in real time. Real time for what it recorded. Let's say it's a 5-second pitch, and you were recording at 10x. That means that's 50 seconds of video that has to be played back into the server. The server then cues it up and plays it back. After 50 seconds, by the MLB rules, the pitcher should have already thrown the next pitch. They have 45 seconds now, I think, between pitches. Now, some of that includes time for the batter to get out of the batter's box and back in, but effectively, zero time for a replay under this scenario. Where does this work? It works in golf. Because I said earlier, the analysis of a swing, you need 10x or more. I spoke with Brad Chaney, who used to be at MLB Network. He is now Fox for the their golf. He runs their golf production. And he was saying he's usually in about 15x on a replay. Why does that work in golf and not in baseball? Because you don't watch golf live. You think that you do. Almost everything you're watching is pre-produced in golf. They bounce from the first hole to the second hole to the third hole, and then all of a sudden, magically, the guy's ready to hit his second shot back at the first hole. You really think that all happened in that time frame and worked out perfectly? They could go from hole 1 to 2 to 3. They don't stop the players. they're constantly in record, and then they post-produce all of it. So they have time to download an analysis of a swing. They already know who they're looking at. If a particular player is slicing the ball constantly, they're looking at the swing, and they're doing the analysis. They have time to download it in those cases. In other sports, hockey is an example, you don't have time for a download like that. The ref's going to drop the puck, unless it's a TV timeout, he's going to drop the puck as soon as he gets there.
Bruce, I have one quick question. Could you go back,
go ahead, Ray.
Could you go back one slide? So when they're doing this 10-second playback out of a camera, at that point the camera is not actually active shooting something. It's really acting like a playback.
It is.
Right?
Yep.
And so for that 10 seconds, it's not doing anything but
it, playback. It actually does a switch between the output of the camera and the internal server, and then it plays it back, which also means that this server down here, the replay server, it only has what was recorded as part of its live feed and those clips that were sent down, but it doesn't have all of the clips. It also has a rolling cache of memory. Some of them actually have four quadrants that they can fill, of four memory banks that they can fill. But once those are filled, they can't have another.
They gotta start dumping stuff.
You gotta drop a replay and go to something else.
Like the old hard disk.
Exactly. Yeah. Go ahead.
Is there a reason that you couldn't have the storage for that camera in the truck? Just have another piece of fiber, whether it's simply fiber or any other fiber.
You could if the camera was designed to send that information down. Those cameras were not. In the case of Grass Valley and Sony, these cameras are designed to send all that information down. Okay. The other thing is, depending upon the look and feel, we're using the same sensor on our high frame rate and our 4K and our 1080p cameras. So when you look at those cameras, you can tell when they show the Phantom, for example, on air. It looks completely different because it doesn't have the same colorimetry. It can't look the same as our camera, because it doesn't have the same matrix. It looks different. Another issue you run into, these lights are flickering at 60 cycles. The human eye can't perceive it. That's why, you know, we don't have an issue with it. In Europe, they flicker at 50 cycles. It's just the electric company. However, if you're capturing at 360 frames per second, you're actually capturing along those cycles. So in our case with a 3X camera, you'll actually have three distinct, and then it will repeat, three more distinct levels of brightness within the image. When you play that back, you get a distinct flicker. If you watch super slow-mo cameras today, if it doesn't flicker, I guarantee you whose camera it is. It's ours. Okay, if it flickers, it's somebody else's camera. Okay, it's a super slow-mo camera, but it doesn't have some kind of an anti-flicker device. Now, there are outboard devices that are being purchased and manufactured today to try and compensate. We actually do it within the camera, so we average out the level across all of the frames so that we get a consistent look and feel. Some of these cameras now are being used in different locations. High frame rate cameras, 4K cameras, are being used in the Eagle Eye for football. High frame rate behind the net for the NBA playoffs. We actually provided a box camera for that. So you can see different places where 4K cameras can be used. Ira Goldstone had asked that in the presentation I include something on high dynamic range. So here goes my best at it. And if you have questions, I'll do the best I can to answer it. This I took directly from a white paper that Dolby produced called Dolby Vision. If you Google search Dolby Vision, you will find the white paper. I recommend it as an excellent read. They do a very, very good job of describing high dynamic range and why it's important. Okay? Effectively, they start off the argument, and I would agree with this, that there are three ways to improve the picture quality. One is improve the resolution. Go from standard definition to high definition, go to high definition to 4K or ultra, go to 8K or whatever. That's going to improve the picture quality. Another way is to improve the temporal resolution. Go to a higher frame rate. You'll get better resolution, and you can actually use that for replay, things like that. The last way to do it, these, by the way, have serious bandwidth implications. Okay? HD is 4 times SD in bandwidth and storage. 4K is 4 times HD, is 16 times SD. The numbers just add up. In this case, it's linear. 3x is 3 times the bandwidth, 6x is 6 times the bandwidth, 8x is 8 times the bandwidth. Pretty straightforward. Improve the pixel. Effectively no change in bandwidth. That's important to note. I mean, I was talking about 4K as being expensive. 4 times the routing switcher is usually more than 4 times the cost. Routing switchers grow exponentially. So do the costs. Okay? Some background information. A NIT. What is a NIT? It's a measure of luminance. And it's effectively the luminance from one candle power. To be specific, one common tallow candle is how they came to this number. TV sets today are designed to represent 100 nits of brightness, black being around 10 nits, and pure white being at 100. So a range of 90 degrees of granularity, let's say. Now, some TVs can output a brighter picture, like an LCD now is brighter than a CRT would have been. And outdoor displays can be even brighter than that, 400. And if they're built to be in the sun, they can even be brighter than that. But they're still working on a range of 10 to 100 nits. So this LCD at 300 nits jumps in increments of 3. 3, 6, 9, 12. Okay? Back to the 10 to 100. The difference between a blue sky and the sun is 7 nits. It's very, very close. So if you don't have degrees of granularity that allow you to separate the sun from the blue sky, if you shade the camera incorrectly for the sky, it just gets washed out and it's all white. And it's a question of whether, what are you shading for? Are you shading to show the sky? Or are you shading to show the audience below the sky? And I've got a picture that kind of helps with that. Some more background. Over here in this dark area, you probably can't see the numbers, 145 nits. The brown in the center of the petal, 188. The yellow is almost 15,000 nits. The sun, to the naked eye, is 20,000 nits. Okay? Some of the new TVs that are ultra-high definition and have high dynamic range are claiming between 800 and 1,000 nits. Dolby, in their white paper, said they're looking to support 1,000 nits in today's time frame and 10,000 nits in the future. So a huge jump from the 100 nits that are supported today. Also, UHD improves the gamut that we can, the color gamut that we can deal with. So if you look at this yellow triangle, that's what's available today in 1080i or 1080p. The larger black triangle is the wider gamut. So this green, your TV set can't produce it today. Your camera can't capture it today. Not if it has the gamut that it's supposed to be set up for. Okay? So there are colors that you just physically can't see. You can't produce them, and they can't run through the system. They can't get to the home. If you go with a wider color gamut, you give yourself more options for colors that are supported. And the full thing is what nature has given us for our capability with our eye to see. This is a simulation. I can't show you high dynamic range. First of all, I don't know that my computer could set it up. But secondly, the screen isn't set up for high dynamic range. So what I'm showing you is a simulation. Here, imagine if you will, somebody shaded a camera. In this case, I think they took a still image, but imagine if it was video. They shaded a camera, and what did they shade for?
Sky.
Exactly. You see definition. You'll actually see in the cloud, there's a little dark line in the sky. But the sand is hardly recognizable. So it's an underexposed picture they shaded for the sky. You've got 90 nits to deal with. Put the nits where you want them, okay? In this case, they shaded for the sand, and what happened to the sun?
It bleached out.
Yeah, it blooms, because that blue is too close to the sun. It's all the same at that point. And now you have resolution in the sand, and you can see the person by the water. If you use high dynamic range, again, a simulation, you get the resolution in the clouds, you can see the line in the clouds, you can see the person, and you get the range on the sand. You get the details in both the bright whites and in the darks. You actually get it in the mid-range, but it's most apparent in the brights and the darks. We did a shoot on this past 4th of July in New York City for the fireworks. Anybody who has shot fireworks before knows what they look like on a TV camera. Or if you've been home and you've watched the 4th of July Pops concert, they try to do the best they can to shoot the fireworks and make it look exciting. But basically you get a whole bunch of white screens when the explosions go off. And then you see the beautiful circle, but the circle is kind of more of a circle. You don't see stars in that circle. You see kind of blurry blobs. They form a circle, and then they disappear. And as all this happens, the black level in the background is going up and down because the camera's going nuts. Okay? We shot the fireworks. The person doing shading kind of sat there with his hands folded and watched the event. The camera could actually show the explosion and then the retraction, and the speckles on the side looked like little stars. Could it be better? Absolutely. Are we working towards more? Absolutely. But now, to see that, we had to use a Dolby monitor, because the Dolby monitor had to be synced with the camera so that the metadata that's associated with it was displayable. And for moving to the home, the look right now, my understanding is that the best would be to shoot with high dynamic range, capture both the high dynamic range metadata as well as the standard dynamic range metadata, embed the standard dynamic range metadata in the ENS data packets, and send that to the home, and then let the set at home, based on its capability, determine how it's going to resolve all of that. That's my understanding of how it's going to work. You definitely have to consider it when you're building a production studio as maybe something like an XML file or something like that that might run parallel to the process, or something that might be embedded in the ENS data packets so that it travels. So what are some of the other issues that I've seen with situations and storage? If you take a typical video server, we make a bunch of them, and I mean, you can capture HD video anywhere from 35 megabits per second up to 144. You can probably go up to 288, depending on if you're using ProRes or DNX HD. I picked AVC Intra at 100. It's kind of in the middle, works for me. It's also one of the newer formats, so I think it's one of the better ones. If you go at high frame rate, it takes six times as much data. Now, bandwidth, playback bandwidth is not affected, because in the case of high frame rate, we stack all the frames up sequentially in one file. So you end up with one video file, But if you recorded 10 seconds of video, guess what? You actually have 60 seconds of video, 10 seconds of real-time video. If that's what you shot, the file is 60 seconds long. And if, in my example, I say if it's a 30-minute recording, well, that works out to be a three-hour file. So it takes six times as much disk storage space to handle that. If you look at 1080p 60, 3-gig video, you're using AVC Ultra at 200 megabits per second. Well, that's 2x. If quad HD, if 4K is four 3G signals, that means you're talking eight times as much data as 1080i. And you're doing it in four files that you have to manage. Now, the server can generally deal with the four files. If it understands that it's quad HD, it can handle that. There are other costs associated with it. You know, I mentioned that four of everything. Multi-viewers, for the most part, we've seen a mix of people who actually use true 4K coming into their multi-viewer. Other people have taken a fifth signal, increased the size of the router, decreased the size of the cost of the multi-viewer, in which case now the multi-viewer is being fed by 1080i or 1080p, but you're decreasing the cost of the multi-viewer, you're increasing the cost of the router, or you're directly feeding the multi-viewer independently of the router. Go ahead.
For the storage solution, are the hard drives typically spinning mechanical or solid state?
Can be either. Up to now, solid state has generally been about half the size and about twice the money. Okay, so we have 600 and 900 gig drives inside of our servers. We have 400 gig solid state drives. They're usually about twice the money of the 600 gig drives, but they give you a lot more bandwidth. That's how we deal with 6X or 4K footage, is we use solid state drives. One change we're seeing is the solid state drives are now dropping significantly in cost, and they're almost a wash. So we're coming out with 800 gigabyte drives, kind of in the middle of the 6 and the 9s, and they're about the same cost as the 9s. Go ahead.
Previously today, you mentioned MLB had to offload their footage either daily or weekly. Is that done just taking out the hard drive, or is that on like a magnetic?
It's all FTP.
Oh.
It's all FTP. In a case of a large server, SAN, they have kind of daily storage and longer term storage. That's all large SAN networks. They just FTP. Or they move it off to a robotic archive. In their case, they have a SL8500 with, I don't know, eight tape drives in it. SMPTE 2022 is a way of getting most of this around. We're looking at using TECO compression. The Aspen community is looking MPEG-2 transport streams to get 4K onto one wire. That will help with the wiring, but internally it's still four times as much data. That will take us into routing, and I'll try and go through this quickly, just in the interest of your time. Routing switchers today can be one of two or three different types of systems. One can be a routing switcher that has baseband inputs and baseband outputs, and does not have the ability to support an IP or a SMPTE 2022-6 signal. There are others that are baseband inside, but we can put an IP I/O card on it. And what the I/O card does is it actually converts from IP to baseband. And then you're switching in the baseband domain. So you really have a baseband router, but you've got conversion equipment built into the I/O. The third is which you purely have an IP router, and then you have cards in the IP router that are either IP or baseband, and if they're IP, we come in natively IP. If they're baseband, we convert to IP. So a couple of diagrams as we go through it. One of the questions was, well, what components today support IP? Actually, they all do. All of our devices today, this was a big push for NAB last year, all of our devices today have an option of an IP/IO card. That is true of the camera base station. There's an IP version of the camera base station. The production switcher has IO cards on the back. The video servers have IO cards. They all have an option. Is it cheaper to go IP or baseband? Any guesses? You would think that. You would not be correct. It's about twice the cost for the IO card. That is today a supply and demand issue. Those SMPTE 2022 connectors and the SFPs that go in them and things like that are more expensive than a BNC. You use less cable, overall it's still more expensive. Because on a SMPTE 2022, you can put up to like six HD 1.5 gig signals on it. There is overhead, and you have to be careful. So six is kind of a bad number because it puts you up to 9 gigs. And so it puts you up to 9 gigs, but 4 or 5 is not a bad number to support. But still, the reduction in cabling cost compared to the I.O. card doesn't offset itself today. Will that be different by not this NAB, but next NAB? I would guess. I would guess by then they should be even. Go ahead.
Is there a difference in weight between the two systems?
Certainly, a SMPTE 2022 can be on copper or on optical. It's only one versus four. So it would be less weight if it was all copper, and if it was optical, it would be even less weight. So SMPTE would be less weight, which helps the truck market, the full-fledged studio market, like your production here, you don't really care about weight.
Would the network infrastructure be 10G or gigabit or?
SMPTE 2022 is a 10 gig connection today. The back end of that could be 25 or 40 gigs, mm-hmm. And we'll be moving to 100 gig in the near future. At IBC, we actually did a test. Again, we got to prove it out to ourselves to make sure it works. So we had two studios, each with a baseband router, but feeding some IP multiviewers. And then we tied them together because we can put an IP card in our baseband router. So this is our existing router, not the new one we just released. And it was the existing router at the time, and we tied them together through an Arista or a Cisco switch. And we just proved that we could tie two routing switches together through IP. Kind of a simple test, but in the crawl, walk, run kind of scenario, it made sense. And in the time of IBC, which was September of 2014, it made sense. So I'll go through this pretty quickly, but this is a typical baseband system, right? Switchers, cameras, replays, modular products, going down to some kind of a playout scenario, ingest signals coming in. All of that can go into a baseband routing switcher. If you add an IP device and you have a routing switcher that supports an IP card, add the IP card, that gives you some number of IP inputs, and you have more IP inputs. If you have a routing switcher like our Trinix line, which was older, and it was a baseband-only router, it didn't have an IP input, then when you go to IP, put some modular gear in that converts from IP to baseband. And if you've got, you know, more IP, change some other things that convert for you. So you can do that with modular products. If you start with baseband, and then start building out a new facility, now you can put in an all IP router. You can add in a unified control system that deals with controlling both baseband and IP routing. But now you're truly switching in the IP domain, and you can tie in IP devices. So your new devices can be on the new router. Okay? And you can add devices to it as you go along. If you start with that generic router and you move into a more distributed routing architecture, now you can add devices that are IP or baseband into the new architecture and start building out based on that and expand there. So there are ways to get from existing routing today to IP routing, to have hybrid routers in the middle, or to have two separate routers that communicate with one another. You had a question?
That kind of answered my question. I wasn't sure if this is like all more of like a dedicated network with this routing equipment, or can you kind of interweave or fold that into your pre-existing network?
And you can. And you can expand. If you've got a greenfield facility, you would go all IP routing. However, the IP router can also have baseband inputs, so you can still deal with legacy equipment that doesn't have a SMPTE 2022 connector on it without having to externally convert that to IP to bring it in. And there's where you'd look at what's the cost of converting it externally versus doing it within the router. And on a case-by-case basis, you may actually have some cases where a customer might go one or both ways. There are two communities, and this is more just general information. I took all this information from the Ames site, and then I went to the Aspen site, and I took their information. As this is a SMPTE discussion, I have no comments to make on either side of this. Ames is the Alliance for IP Media Solution. It is one industry group that was founded by one company, and a number of companies have joined in. And they're looking to find solutions. They're using video services, technical release 03 and 04. They're using TECO compression, and they're basing it around SMPTE 2022 connectors. That is straight from Ames. Aspen has been formed by another company. There are another group of manufacturers that have joined in. They are basing theirs on MPEG-2 transport streams. They're using SMPTE standards for audio over transport as well as ANTS data over transport, and they're supporting the SMPTE 2022 family of products. Those are quotes directly from each website. In the interest of, again, of this being SMPTE, I tried to, go ahead, Pat.
So the IP, is that like the standard soup that's available? What is the
SMPTE 2022?
Yeah, that's it.
Right.
You just answered the question.
Yeah. Okay. SMPTE 2022 is the physical connection and the standard, the SMPTE standard.
Okay, cool.
And it refers to, because it's a 10 gig connection, you can embed in the data packets what you want. So that could be 4 or 5 1080i signals. It could be like 3 1080p 60 signals. That would be 9 gigs of data. There is, and I'm clearly not an expert on this, there is a point where distance and jitter become an issue, and if you have too much bandwidth in the signal, you can run into issues. So filling up the 10 gigs is not a good idea. I've heard that somewhere between 80 and 90% is a good safe argument. That actually came from Mark Hilton and Lee Buchanan talking about how much data we can put into a 2022 signal today. And some of that, again, has to go with the distance that it's going to travel and the product that it's coming from. If it has a very stable product that it's coming from and they output a very good 2022 signal, you're going to be able to go further with it than if it's a lower cost product. And that's no different than baseband 1080i, 1080p. Years ago, everybody was talking about, well, there's a cliff effect at 100 meters. Some products couldn't make 100 meters, even though that's the standard. The standard is you're supposed to be able to get to that distance. There are many kind of off-the-shelf prosumer type products that don't adhere to that part of the standard. There are other products, other manufacturers that claim they could go 140 meters and things like that. I think that, good reclockers and things like that do a better job and therefore can take you know, better advantage. But clearly, buyer beware in those scenarios. And if you're designing a system, whether it be SMPTE 2022 or whether it be baseband, don't consider what something can do today. I have seen customers who have talked about, well, okay, I can run baseband. I can run 1080i, 100 meters, and I make the connection, the router's happy, everything's happy, and dirt and other things, connections can age. You put more cable into the facility, and now instead of a nice smooth path, everything is crushed down, and cable gets compressed, and all of a sudden, you don't have all the signals that you had before, and you wonder, where did they go to? Well, you should have thought about that when you started the design process. Whether that's you, the engineer, whether that's the systems integrator or the consultant who designs your project, you definitely have to leave a lot of headroom, because things don't get better. You make them worse as you add on to a facility. You challenge things more. That's not a bad thing. I mean, it can have negative effects. You just need to compensate for it and think about that up front.
Does 2022 support variable bit depths?
I believe the answer is yes. It certainly is. Oh, wait a minute. Compression ratios or bit depths on the signals? If you're talking bit depths on the signals, yeah. Yes. Right?
When you were talking about distance here with 2022, what's a ballpark number there?
Because it goes over copper and optical, I think there would be two different ones. It's a 10-bit signal. I don't know the answer, Ray. Obviously, the optical is going to be, you know, great distances. I know that, for example, just by way of comparison, Triax is like 4,000 feet. SMPTE is like 1.5 miles. Single mode fiber is 25 miles. So, you know, obviously, optical is going to get you much longer distances. In the case of 2022 at 10 gig, I don't know the answer to that. There was another, go ahead.
Could I back you up to the slide that you had that had the, maybe four or five back, but it was the one that had the 40 gig connections. Yeah, that's good. That's perfect.
Okay.
So, in the right-hand side, the SDN routing control.
Yes.
Where is that going right now? Is that standard off-the-shelf, or quote-unquote off-the-shelf SDN, or is this something that's sort of going to become specific to?
We're using, and so would everybody else who is doing IP routing, would be using SDN within our own router control. So it would be, in this case, a Grass Valley router control system using SDN within that. We would also be talking to baseband routers as we do traditionally, cross-point type control. In this case, we would be using SDN, whether we do it routing within the frame or routing within larger systems over COTS or our own fabric for larger routing systems. And I'm sure that Everts and Probel and Utah are all doing the same thing within their routing control system. Yeah.
So would it be open flow based, or is that?
Yes,
it is
that is one of the terms that I'm aware of.
Okay.
I couldn't tell you much more about it than that, but I do know that open flow, and there's another term that's very similar to that. Open network and open flow, are those the two? Are part of SDN. And for those that aren't familiar with it, typically in IP routing, you can have a signal go different paths. You specifically want to make sure a signal gets from point A to point B, especially if we're talking 4K and it can be four different signals, that they go the same path so that the timing is the same. If you don't use SDN, if you use just traditional IP control, that signal could actually change paths as other switches come in. You can't have that happen in a real-time network. So SDN is a way, as I understand it, of controlling a fabric like an HP switch or an Arista switch such that When it makes a connection, it keeps that connection and doesn't change it, and it makes that connection in a very deterministic way. That's critically important to timing and signal flow in a real-time network. Other questions? Those are my last slides. Thank you very much. I appreciate the time.
Just want to mention that our next meeting is tentatively scheduled for February 24th over at Channel 5, WCVB, on ATSC 3.0 and its implications as it becomes implemented. And many of you may not be too familiar with ATSC 3.0 yet, but when you have to get a set-top box, I think you'll become more familiar with it. We're going to have Dr. Rich Chernock, who is the outgoing chairman of ATSC, so it should be a very enlightening evening. I hope you all can make it. As we close out, if Tim is here for the studio tour, there we go. See Tim and get a tour of everything that's here. Thank you.
So, our performance actually, everybody in this room is it.